Okay, in this video I'm going to continue on with my tutorials on complex numbers. This is video number 3, and once again I'm trying to show you all you need to know in order to work with complex numbers. I'd like that you just give me a bit of slack, I suppose, with my handwriting. I know it's quite terrible, but that's because I'm writing on a stylus that I'm not quite used to yet. So just in some revision, what we've seen so far is the following. We've defined iota as a complex number as the square root of minus 1. And we've also defined a general complex number existing on the complex number plane as x plus I times y. And in order to get its complex conjugate, you change the sign on the complex or imaginary component. In order to add two complex numbers, we do this. In order to multiply two complex numbers, we do this. And in order to divide two complex numbers, the procedure is, that's what we have there for, the procedure is that we multiply above and below by the complex conjugate of the denominator. And finally, the most general way to look at an imaginary number is that it exists as a real component plus I times the imaginary component. Okay, so on our Argand diagram, the real component is here, and the imaginary component is up here. And we might have something like that. Okay, so I said in the last video, at the end of the last video, we're going to now use Euler's formula. So what we showed was we could rewrite our Argand diagram as something using cosines and sines. So for example, we would have had y is equal to a sine theta, x is equal to a cos theta, where theta is here, this is the magnitude of the complex number, and z is equal to x plus I times y. Alright, now what we showed was that z is equal to a outside of cos theta plus I times sine theta. Oh. And I suppose the question we need to ask ourselves is, why is this useful? It's useful for the following reason. Now, if you need to look at Taylor expansions, you can look at my videos on thermodynamics, and I have quite a few on Taylor expansions. I did the expansions for cosine, sine, and the exponential function. So you can, I suppose, accept it, or what I'm saying now, or you can look at my other videos. Anyway, what I showed is as follows. If we take the Taylor expansion of e to the x, we get the following. 1 plus x plus x squared over 2 factorial plus x cubed over 3 factorial. Now, the next thing is, if we look at e to the I theta, it's going to be the same, but we plug in I theta every place that we had x. So it's 1 plus I theta plus, minus theta squared over 2 and so on. So it's 1. Alright, now the trick here is to group the complex and the real components together. So we're going to get the following, that e to the I theta is real components plus imaginary components. And we get our imaginary components next. Okay, now, what's interesting here is, if you actually look at this, if you look at the Taylor expansions of both cosine and sine, you'll find that this is the Taylor expansion of cosine, and this is the Taylor expansion of sine. So what we have is as follows. We have e to the I theta is cos theta plus I times sine theta. And that's Euler's formula. And that is one of the most important formulas in physics, in mathematics. It's an absolutely amazing formula, and you'll be using it all the time, especially if you're doing any sort of physics. Okay, so just to rewrite Euler's formula, e to the I theta is cos theta plus I times sine theta. Okay, so now that we have Euler's formula, what can we do with it? Well, we can rewrite, we can rewrite z as follows. You can write z, which we said earlier on, was a outside of, let's say, cos plus I sine. Now it just becomes a times e to the I theta. What about z star? Z star is simply a multiplied by e to the minus I theta. Okay, so why is this useful? Why do we even care about this? Well, we saw earlier on how to do the operations like multiplication, division, subtraction, and so on using normal complex numbers. But using this complex representation makes life so much easier. For example, z1, z2 becomes a1, a2 outside of e to the I theta 1 plus theta 2. If we take the, that's multiplication. Addition is straightforward as well. What if we look at division? Division was something which was reasonably difficult the last time. We had a procedure multiplying above and below by the complex conjugate. But here what we get is a1 over a2. And we have e to the I theta 1 minus theta 2. That's pretty straightforward. Now, let's look at some other properties of the exponential which make life easier. If we raise e to the power of z1 plus z2, we can see that it's e to the z1 multiplied by e to the z2. That's a very useful property, and you need to get to know that property. What if we look at e to the z? Well, where z is a complex number. Okay, but using this particular property here, we get e to the x plus e to the I times y, or times e to the I times y. Okay, simple. Now, just to show you a few more useful properties. What if we get the modulus of our complex number? Remember, z is x plus I times y. Okay, now, so let's look at this. So we have the following. To get the modulus of z is equal to z times z star, and we need to square root it. So the modulus of your complex number is just is e to the x, okay, e to the x. That's very important. Now for a few more very important properties of this which make life easier. We know, of course, that the cos of 2 pi is equal to 1. We know that the sine of 2 pi is equal to naught. Why is that useful? Of course it's useful because that means e to the I 2 pi, which we'll say becomes 1, because we've cos theta plus I times sine theta. Okay, so we're plugging 2 pi instead of theta, and we get 1. What about e to the I pi? Well, e to the I pi is going to be the same as e to the minus I pi, and that's simply going to be 1 as well. Okay, and finally, e to the plus or minus I pi over 2, 90 degrees, is going to be plus or minus I. Okay, and just flying through these now, because to be honest, once you've seen them, they become pretty straightforward. But all of these are the sorts of things, if you're starting to manipulate complex numbers, you're going to need to know these. Now, an important property is the following, and this is probably the most important of the lot. If I can't find my cursor, we'll be fine. Okay. So, because cos and sine are periodic, and because we know that complex numbers, cos and sines are complex exponentials, that means that e to the I theta is also periodic. Okay, so let's look at that. That means e to the z plus I 2 pi is equal to e to the z times e to the I 2 pi. As follows, e to the z. So we have our periodic property here, something we'll be using all the time in our optics. What about that? What about the fact that any complex number can be represented as the sum of the real part and the imaginary part? So just once more to write it, we have z is equal to the real part of z plus the imaginary part of z multiplied by I. Okay, so what that means is the real part of z is r cos theta. Or a cos theta, depending on what are you using, the radius, or what are you using. And the imaginary part of z is equal to a sine theta. Okay, nothing new. And the final interesting property I'm going to show you is the following thing here. That e to the I pi plus 1 is equal to naught. Now, many people say that this is the most interesting property or interesting formula in all of mathematics. Why is that? I'll show you now. Well, first of all, if you to draw it, we go from, if we have our unit circle, well, e to the I pi brings us the whole way around to here, minus 1, we know that. But if we add 1 to it, get back to here, and what we have is that e to the I pi plus 1 is 0. Now, why do people think it's important? Why do people think this is an interesting equation? Well, look what it has. It's got the number. It's got, first of all, iota. It has pi, 0, it's 1, it's got e. It's got pretty much all of the really important numbers that we see all over mathematics and all over physics. Okay, so this particular equation is very beautiful in many respects. Okay, so that's all I want to show you about this. In the next video, which is going to be quite short, I'm going to show you how we convert from complex exponentials to sinusoids. Okay, so thanks for watching. Please pass it on to your friends. Subscribe to my channel, and you might also add a comment below.